Thank you, team. What a wonderful, multi-talented team we have. Musicians and reporters and time travelers as well. It's amazing. So let me pray. Father, we've just been singing those beautiful words that about being still in your presence, because your presence is here. And we thank you, Jesus, that you are here in our midst today. Lord Jesus, you caused this letter of Paul's to be written so many thousands of years ago. And I pray that through your grace and your mercy, you might bring this letter to life today in our hearts and our minds as we read and reflect on it. Help me as I speak, that I might speak and teach your word well. And I pray for these dear people who are here this morning, that you might help them to listen well. And together we might be built up in our holy faith and be equipped to serve you more faithfully. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. In case you don't know me, my name is John Anderson. I'm the director of Tali Ministries. Tali was established initially by the Australian Agricultural Company in 1826. And our current mission started there in 1949, running camps and conventions. And in 1959, established a Bible College. Bible College was established to train people for pioneer missionary work. We are continuing on that training, but in slightly different ways. So what I'm doing this morning is hopefully explaining a little bit about the Bible, Paul's letter to Colossians. We'll be speaking about Colossians today and next Sunday, God willing. But also in the midst of that, I want to explain a little bit and show you a little bit about what's happening at Tali in our current training non-Western missionaries for mission. And in a little while, I'm going to invite Patricia back up again, and also Evelyn, who's from Bolivia. So you can just see in a visual way the training for the changing world of mission. And that's the other big aim that I have today. This church is very faithful in praying for people involved in mission. One of the things that I do, in addition to being the director of Tali Ministries, and I'm also the chair of the national leadership team of Missions Interlink, which is the peak body for missions in Australia. So I get involved in missions generally. And so there's a lot of things that are happening in the changing world of mission. And so I want to help you this morning, I hope, to change the way you think about mission. And we'll talk a little bit more about that in a moment. But I'd like to go back to this passage, and Andrew, if I may, have that passage of scripture up again. I believe the Bible and the Word of God is so important to us. We need to keep thinking about it and focusing on it. We get inundated with so much information. Information overload. So this morning is just going to be very simple, focusing on this first chapter of Paul's letter to the Colossians. And we had a bit of an introduction to that a moment ago. So I want to highlight some of the truths that come out of this passage. We thought a little bit about prayer earlier. And I want to focus on something about the gospel and the spreading of the good news for a few moments. Let me read again in verse 3. Paul is writing, he says, "We always pray for you and we give thanks to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. We have heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and your love for all of God's people, which comes from your confident hope of what God has reserved for you in heaven." You pick up those three themes of Paul that are common in his letters: faith, hope, and love. He mentions them here. You have this expectation, that is, of confident hope, ever since you first heard the truth of the good news. That same good news that came to you is going out all over the world. We're going to hear about that in a moment. It is bearing fruit everywhere by changing lives, just as it has changed your lives from the day you first heard it and understood the truth about God's wonderful grace. Wonderful truth, isn't it? The gospel changes lives. If I was to ask you this morning to tell me about your experience, how has The gospel, the good news of Jesus, changed your life. Paul will go on to say in a moment how we've been brought from darkness into God's wonderful life. He's spoken here about hope and a future. That's the sort of transformation that the gospel brings for people. People who have no hope because they're facing eternal judgment by God, they're coming into a hope and a future through the gospel. Paul speaks about that, and he experienced that as he taught and wrote and shared the gospel. He saw people's lives transformed. Paul goes on to say in verse 7, you learned about the good news from Epaphras. We heard about that this morning. Our beloved co-worker. He is Christ's faithful servant, and he is helping us on your behalf. He has told us about the love for others that the Holy Spirit has given you. So we have not stopped praying for you since we first heard about you. We ask God to give you complete knowledge of his will, to give you spiritual wisdom and understanding. Then the way that you live, the result of the prayer, then the way that you live will always honor and please the Lord. And your lives will produce every kind of good fruit. And a wonderful outcome of prayer. All the while you will grow as you learn to know God better and better. Wonderful purpose in life. I pray the blessing that was like that to start with. The result of the gospel, the transformation of our lives, is that we get to know God better and better. I'm sure whether you understand how radical that is in the time that Paul was writing. In the ancient Near East, and often in religious circles around the world today, the gods that people worship are distant and fickle and unpredictable. And people had to go through certain ceremonies to get the gods to do certain things for them. They certainly weren't in a relationship with God. That was quite strange. And so for Paul to say, write this, that we should get to know God better and better. The triune God is a God of relationships, and he invites us into that relationship with him to get to know him better and better. Wonderful truth. He goes on to pray, we also pray that you'll be strengthened with all of his glorious power, so you'll have all the endurance and patience you need. May you be filled with joy, always thanking the Father. He has enabled you to share in the inheritance that belongs to his people who live in the light. Wonderful truth, isn't it? We share in the inheritance that belongs to his people who live in the light. He has rescued us from the kingdom of darkness. Here's the beautiful truth. He has rescued us from the kingdom of darkness and transferred us into the kingdom of his dear Son, who purchased our freedom from the going of our sins. What a wonderful statement of the gospel. You've been rescued from darkness and transformed into the wonderful kingdom of God's Son. Purchased our freedom and forgiven our sins. I want to think just for a moment about the changing world of mission. When you saw Patricia up here earlier, you thought about, and she was talking about Papua New Guinea, many of us would have prayed about missionaries going to Papua New Guinea. Yeah? Who's ever prayed for a missionary and everybody in the missionary go to Papua New Guinea? Papua New Guinea was a great mission field from Australia. We would send missionaries to Papua New Guinea. It's like we were sending missionaries from the West, the Christian part of the world, to the rest of the world, the non-Christian part. We are in Christendom, Christian world, and people over here are in darkness, and we are sending missionaries to there. So what surprises you when Patricia comes up and talks about the fact that she is going as a missionary, she is a missionary, going to China? What's strange about that? It's a changing world of mission, isn't it? Places where we once sent missionaries to are now sending missionaries out. Isn't that amazing? That the work of the gospel, see what Paul says here, the same good news that came to you is going out all over the world. The good news that came to Papua New Guinea is now spreading out. I think Papua New Guinea in some ways is probably more of a Christian country than Australia is. It's probably all Baptists in Papua New Guinea, there aren't in Australia. So the good news is now going out from Papua New Guinea to all over the world. We've had a couple of Patricias here. There's another Patricia who was here earlier, and she had been in Pakistan sharing the good news, and has been in Thailand sharing the good news. Back in Papua New Guinea at the moment, maybe in Northern Australia. She's in Cairns at the moment sharing the gospel. The world of mission has changed. The countries that once received missionaries are now sending out missionaries. We used to say, from the west to the rest. What do we say now? From anywhere to everywhere. God is shaking up our world in an amazing way, bringing people to Australia, to countries where we once wanted to send people. In fact, there are people in Australia that we couldn't send missionaries to because the country was closed. And they're now in Australia. In a moment, I'm running out of time really quickly, but in a moment, there's another call, isn't it?
Oh, yes, it is.
I'm around there. One of the things that we're doing in Tali, so we used to prepare people, so people here in Australia, we were trained to go out and find new missionary work. But it's a different world now. And part of my role in thinking about mission is helping people in Australia adjust to this changing world. And what we are doing in Tali, one of the little things that we're doing in Tali, is helping people who come from different cultures who want to go out as missionaries, but they need some tools to be missionaries today. Tali, at one stage when we trained people for mission, we used to teach them about building houses and fixing cars and being able to do plumbing, all sorts of practical things, because they were going into remote areas where those services weren't available. We were training people to pioneer missionary work. What are the skills that people need today for mission? Well, to recognize that people today are not coming from Western countries, so they need to be able to speak English. Why English? Well, English is the lingua franca, the common language across the world. So if you talk to a previous Patricia we had, who was working in Pakistan, she had people from 10 different countries in her mission team. And guess what the common language was? English. The leader of the team was a Korean, but English was the language of the team. But to get into some areas, like Patricia is doing, going into China, she needs a way to be able to get in, a tool to get a visa. What's the way of getting a visa?
Teach English.
So what do we do at Tali? We teach people to teach English. And we help people learn to speak English. It's a missionary tool. What else people need to do is be able to work in community, because our world, we've got people coming from different cultural backgrounds, different cultures, and they have to learn to work together. Do you know what the biggest reason is that people leave serving God in mission? What's the biggest reason?
Feeling isolated?
Broken relationships.
Broken relationships. Conflict with people on the mission team. Because it's so difficult for people to work together. So when we put Tali, we bring people to Tali to live in community, to learn to serve together, to learn about different cultures. The other thing we've done just recently is caring about the environment. So the changing world of mission. I'm just going to invite up quickly Patricia again and Evelyn to come up, just because they're my visual aids. Could you guys just come forward for a moment? Again, just so we picture this, because it's so hard to change our way of thinking about mission. At Tali at the moment, we have the international director of Wycliffe Global Alliance, Pope Franklin. And he is talking to Wycliffe Bible translators, and he's talking about the whole changing world of mission, what's happening around the world in mission. You know that 70% of the missionaries now are going out are coming from non-Western countries. Korea and Brazil are some of the biggest sending countries. And I wanted these beautiful ladies to come up here, so this just reminds us of this wonderful truth. Let me read it again. This same good news that came to you is going out over all the world. It is bearing fruit everywhere by changing lives, just as it changed our lives. We've heard about Patricia's story coming from Papua New Guinea, really isolated community, but with a wonderful gift of learning language. In Papua New Guinea, lots of different languages. So what's Patricia's gift? The ability to learn and understand language. And coming from a culture like Papua New Guinea, a much greater acceptance. She has a greater acceptance in remote areas of China than Western missionaries do, and she can live much simpler than Western missionaries do. Bit of a challenge in working with Western missionaries again. Let me tell you the story about Evelyn. Hopefully you get to know Evelyn as time goes on. Evelyn is studying indigenous languages. She's a linguist. And she comes from Cochabamba. Do you know anything about Cochabamba? We've had some other people from Cochabamba here. We've got Kapia and Amelia. What else do you know about Cochabamba? Where my wife, Juanita, went to school. So my parents-in-law went as pioneer missionaries to Bolivia, to the little village, to share the gospel. And now we have people coming from Bolivia to Australia to learn English and go out and serve God in different places. Thank you, ladies. I just wanted people to see you so you can pray for them. Remember how we talked about prayer earlier? You can pray for these beautiful ladies as they seek to understand God's will and God's purpose for their lives. There is a changing world of mission. And we, you and I, can be partners in that. Tali's got a little role in helping train and equip. But you are supporting us at Tali so that we can help train and equip others so that they can go out and share the gospel all around the world. What a wonderful partnership we have in the gospel. Trust and pray you might continue to pray for the spread of the gospel around the world. I'm going to close by reading the next section of Colossians to you. Susan started the service by talking, and I think Dan must have been speaking about suffering last week, and about this changing world. Do you get anxious at times about the changing world we live in? All that is happening, and we can't keep in up to date with the fragile nature of this world. I want to close by reading this beautiful hymn. It was part of the early church's worship that reminded them in their changing world about the thing that doesn't change. The supremacy of Christ. He is the one foundation that doesn't change. Let me just read these beautiful words to you as I close. Christ is the visible image of the invisible God. He existed before anything was created and is supreme over all creation. For through him, God created everything in the heavenly realms on earth. He made the things we can see and the things we can't see, such as thrones and kingdoms and rulers and authorities in the unseen world. Everything was created through Jesus and for Jesus. Everything was created through him and for him. He existed before anything else, and he holds the whole creation together. Christ is the head of the church, which is his body. He is the beginning, supreme over all who rise from the dead. He is the first in everything, for God in all his fullness was pleased to live in Christ. And through him, God reconciled everything to himself. He made peace with everything in heaven and on earth by means of Christ's blood on the cross. The one thing Jesus, we acknowledge your supremacy, that all things have been made by you. And we acknowledge your authority, your supreme and overarching authority over everything that happens. Nothing that happens in this world is out of your control. So we submit and acknowledge that this morning. And we ask, Lord God, that we might continue to submit to you and to your work in the world. Thank you for your wonderful mission. We thank you for what you are doing in the world. Help us to be part of that and continue to love you and to serve you, to be faithful, serving you with what you give us here in this place. Thank you for this beautiful word. Pray that it might transform our lives.